Matt and Dan recently performed a tyre width test on the cobbles of Flanders to find out whether wider tyres really are faster over rougher roads. Now, they filmed it on a particularly cold day in Flanders, so I thought it'd be a good idea to delve a little deeper into the subject, but in the dry and the warm. So let's geek out and find out why different tyre widths could lead to different speeds, and maybe even why you might not quite have seen the results that you were expecting. Now, if you haven't watched that video yet, then do make sure you go and check it out. The methodology was to use the same bikes, wheels and tyre pressures, meaning that the only controlled variable was the width of their tyres. Now, there was, of course, no accounting for weather conditions, or in fact, for Dan and Matt, more to the point, but they did ride the same section of cobbles three times at the same set power. Minimising those variables as best they could, any speed difference, therefore, would have to come from different tyre widths. Or you'd hope so anyway. Now, here are the results of that test. As you can see, Matt was slightly faster as the tyres got wider, and Lloydie, well, not really any change at all. So statistically, not significant results then. Sorry about that, chaps. But it was not a wasted day out in the cold, not at all. It is interesting nevertheless, because we might have expected to see faster times for wider tyres. So what is actually going on? Well, we're going to break this down into three parts: contact patch, both hysteresis and slip angle, and aerodynamics. Why might they have been faster then? Well, wider tyres mean that the contact patch between the tyre and the ground is shorter and wider compared to a narrower tyre, when the inflation pressures are equal. The shorter the contact patch, the less rolling resistance it will generate, and therefore the faster you go. Now, the reason being that while the contact area is the same between the widths, the longer and narrower shape of the narrower tyre requires the tyre to deflect more as you roll. Deflection that requires energy in a process called hysteresis. Basically, as the rubber in the carcass of the tyre deforms and rebounds as you roll, an amount of energy is lost in the form of heat. A wider tyre, therefore, suffers less hysteretic loss. Now, as an aside, when you couple wider tyres with wider rims, like the new Bontragers that they were using, the contact patch becomes even shorter. Although we have to say that given that was consistent across all the tests, it won't actually have influenced the results. But I thought it was interesting anyway. Now, another advantage of that wider contact patch is when the test sector requires side-to-side grip, so like cornering or getting on and off the crown of the road. Now, this is due to what is called the slip angle, which is the angle between a wheel's actual direction of travel and the direction it's pointing. Now, it is a super complicated picture, but effectively, a shorter contact patch reduces the slip angle, meaning that the tyre should effectively grip better. More grip means faster through turns, shorter time taken for the run. You would have thought. What about aerodynamics then? A narrow profile is faster, right? Well, yes, unless it's too narrow. So let me explain. To shorten the contact patch of the tyre, rims have been getting wider internal diameters, which we touched on earlier. But they have also been getting wider to improve aerodynamics with wider tyres, which actually means now that if a narrower tyre is fitted to a wide rim, the rim itself will literally stick outside of the tyre, and a lip like that is obviously really bad aerodynamically. A wider tyre, meanwhile, will cause smoother airflow over the edge of the rim. However, it's only true up to a certain point. Once a tyre gets too wide, no matter how wide the rim, the increased frontal area of the tyre negates the benefit of improved rolling resistance. So this is why professional riders aren't riding around on slick mountain bike tyres. In fact, when I asked Zip during the 650B video, they estimated that a 47mm wide tyre would need about 20 watts more than a 30mm tyre. So imagine what it would be compared to that 23mm tyre right there. So from all of that, we would expect to see some speed improvements as the tyre got wider in our test, assuming that 28mm tyres are not over the tipping point of being too wide. And put it this way, estimation from Envy when they released their latest super wide SES 4.5 AR wheels suggested that a 28 compared to a 25 was literally just a couple of watts. Would that though be enough to offset any improvements from the contact patch? Well, I don't know, but it may explain why there was a mixed picture from our data. Or maybe it's because, as with all GCN does science, we needed more of it, more data. And to be honest, it's probably because we controlled one aspect of setting up the tyres that actually needed to be a variable, tyre pressure. One of the main reasons for using wider tyres is that you can run them at lower pressures without increasing the risk of pinch punctures, which are especially an issue on the cobbles of Flanders and indeed Northern France. And then why would you want to run lower pressures in the first place? Well, that is the most important thing, and it is a topic for a future video, literally because Dan and Matt went back and repeated their test, but varying the tyre pressure instead. The differences in results there will be due to reduced suspension losses relative to hysteretic loss and aerodynamic drag. It is a hugely important component to reducing rolling resistance, and we will get into it next week. Until then, geek out. See what I did there? Anyway, do make sure you check out Dan and Matt's video if you haven't seen it already. You can get through to it just down there. And please give this video a big thumbs up if you, like me, like a bit of geeking out.